stick to it. It gives me nothing back. No manuscripts to store away, no paintings to show on walls or hang in museums, no poems to be printed or sold. Nothing. But the single fleeting moment when you feel alive. Merce Cunningham, 1919 to 2009. When Mrs. Carruthers told us that we had to give a 1-hour oral presentation on the subject of our choice, I knew what I was going to do. When we had to do an essay on biomechanics, I studied the pirouette. When we had to present an example of communication, I cast my friends in an all-singing, all-dancing spectacular about the telephone, inspired by the Doris Day film Pillow Talk. When we had to do a project on dinosaurs, I did Isadora Duncan. Mrs. Carruthers is like, Jacob, we need to find more variety in your topics. So this time, I'm going bigger. Better. I'm doing 100 years of the history of dance, as told by one man in 60 minutes with an energetic group finale. Yes, a century of history is difficult to tackle, and yes, if you do the maths, that is 1.6 years per minute. But I have set myself a goal, and when you set yourself a goal, you will achieve it. Do it big, do it right, and do it with style. Fred Astaire, 1899 to 1987. I know everything there is to know about these guys. I have done my homework. But Jacob, I hear you ask, how are you going to tell us about it? Well, I'm not going to go chronologically. But Jacob, I hear you ask, why aren't you going chronologically? Well, class, thank you for these questions. I'm not going chronologically because everyone overlaps. Every choreographer in history looks around them to see what everyone else is doing and behind them to see what's already been done. So, we're going to climb the family tree of influence. Me, I'm not really on that tree yet. I haven't really choreographed anything, but I'll have my own little branch one day. I'll get there. One thing that you have to know about the history of dance is that it's messy. It can't be told in a straight line. Think of it as a time-traveling game of snakes and ladders. Everyone is influenced by everyone else, but everyone wants to be remembered for being the first. One thing I have noticed about the world of dance is that it loves its titles. Anyone who is anyone has a title. It's like a royal family where everyone has a place. You've got the God of Dance, Vaslav Nijinsky. The Lord of the Dance, Rudolf Nureyev. Also Michael Flatley, but that was self-named. The King of Pop, Michael Jackson. The Queen of Ballet, Margot Fonteyn. The Queen of Dance, Shakira. According to BuzzFeed. The Godmother of Japanese Contemporary Dance, Nika Kurosawa. The Godmother of Belgian Dance, Andries de Kiersemaeker. The Father of Ballet, Marius Petipa. The Father of American Ballet, George Balanchine. The Father of Modern Dance, Ted Shawn. The Mother of Modern Dance, Isadora Duncan. The Matriarch of Black Dance, Catherine Dunham. The Cultural Ambassador to the World, Alvin Ailey. The Dancer's Pop Star, Janet Jackson. And the Cornerstone of American Dance, Martha Graham. In the 1920s, classical ballet was the hot thing for dance on stage. And classical ballet is all about escapes to other worlds, magical places filled with dancing flowers and animals and mystical creatures and fairies. Awesome! But Martha wanted to design a revolt against ballet. And I love her for this. She wanted to address real human issues with dance. She wanted to find a way to communicate life as we experience it and put that on stage. So, January 8th, 1930. Martha performs a new solo that she's choreographed called Lamentation. And it was weird, it was new, and everyone loved it. She performed it herself. Her company was only a couple of years old at the time, but this quickly became one of her signature works and is still in the repertoire after all this time. It's also part of what Martha called her long woolens period, which basically means she was inspired by stretch jerseys. Now, Now, due to copyright reasons, I'm not going to do the actual Martha Graham's Lamentation, but I'm going to do something inspired by Martha Graham's Lamentation. Also, the fabric that she used was actually purple, but this is all my mum had in her fabric cupboard. Now, Lamentation is subtitled The Dance of Sorrow, but not the sorrow of a specific person, time, or place. The personification of grief itself. Depressed and an alcoholic. She couldn't handle watching other dancers perform the works that she had choreographed for herself. She lost the will to live. She stayed at home, ate very little, and literally drank herself into a coma. Now the 1950s, and postmodernism and contemporary art are in full swing. So artists are stretching their muscles, questioning authenticity and universality and art for art's sake. For Merce Cunningham, this meant,
stuff you, society, don't tell me walking can't be dance.
Who says noise can't be music?
They exist, therefore they are. I don't even care if my work's popular or not.
Like that, but that was the general gist of his work. No stories, no characters, just movements. Merce came across an article about the I Ching, an ancient Chinese text which produces numbers at random. There are 64 hexagons, and some of the lines are broken, and some of the lines are unbroken. You know what? I don't really understand it, but the point is that Merce did. So, Merce would put out bits of paper on the floor, different bits of paper with movements drawn on them, different positions for the arms, legs, and head, and then would use the I Ching to determine the choreographic sequence. His collaborator and life partner, John Cage, would then do the same thing with his musical compositions. He'd write a list of sound possibilities and then let chance decide the order that they would appear in. And then the costumes were chosen at random. And then the lighting was chosen at random. You know, sometimes the dancers didn't even know exactly what the show was going to be until the night of the performance. Let chance decide. Now, some people thought that this whole method of I don't decide, chance decides, was kind of lazy and I'm kind of giving up responsibility for actually doing any work. But let's just remember that Merce was genuinely interested in finding choreography that couldn't be found using traditional choreographic methods. It is important to remember, though, that not everything he made using this trick was a masterpiece. Those that didn't work quickly fell out of the repertoire, and those that did are now celebrated as serendipitous discoveries. So I suppose at some point you do have to make some decisions. Have I only done two choreographers? Right, I've got so much more than I need to tell you because I promised myself that I would do what I would do for 100 years. So, okay, alright, I just have to keep going. Okay. Changed that. She formed her company, Rosas, in 1983, and her dance film, Rosas Dance Rosas, got the company world attention. It won multiple awards and is still studied by students today. So when that dance film was copied, shot for shot, for a music video by Beyoncé. Ha 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 ha! Let's just say, everyone is influenced by everyone else. Some of that influence is more obvious than others, but we'll I think that's why I haven't choreographed anything yet. Because I want to be high profile, like these guys, but I don't want to be accused of stealing. I have to make something original and brilliant. And Mum always says, oh, if Jacob can't do it perfectly the first time, he doesn't want to do it at all. And she's right. But it's really tricky. Because what is the difference between referencing and copying? We're all watching each other. I myself started dancing because I was watching Mary Poppins and wanted to dance like the chimney sweeps. I also wanted to dance like the waiters in Hello, Dolly. Oh. All choreographers were or are dancers, but not all dancers end up as choreographers, and we are grateful for that. But we really can't talk about the history of dance without mentioning Rudolf Nureyev. He was absolutely a choreographer. He created and restaged many ballets, but he's most famous for those moments when he stepped out on stage. Nureyev's influence over the world of ballet changed the perception of male dancers forever. In his own productions, the male dancers had so much more to do. He's also one of the first dancers to ever cross the borders between classical ballet and modern dance. Today it's really normal to see dancers train in both those styles, but Nureyev was the first. He went out of his way to work with Martha Graham, who made a solo especially for him. So, let's go back. 1938. A little baby boy is born on a train, while the mother is travelling to visit the father, who's a Red Army political commissar. Jump to that same boy, now 7 years old, a closeted little gay boy in Russia. Apparently his father would take him to the public baths and then would beat him whenever he got an erection. Little Rudy first discovered dance by learning Bashkir folk dance at school. And he was so naturally talented and worked so hard that by the time he was 17, he moved to St. Petersburg to train in ballet. And it was here that he met Tezja Kreki, another young man at the Vagana Academy. Rudolf says that Tezja was his first crush, who taught him the art of male love. Although a lot of other lovers since then have said that Rudolf usually skips the art bit. After graduation, Rudolf went to work with the Kirov Ballet. And in 1958, on his debut performance, the intermission went on for nearly an hour because Rudolf didn't like the costume. I will not be wearing these short trousers. They are like lampshades. I have seen the photographs of the Western dancers and they are wearing tights. Tights! I will wear tights. So he wore tights. I mean, we can hardly blame him. He looks amazing in tights. With great talent comes a little bit of attitude. Rudolf was apt to throw tantrums in public. His impatience usually showed itself when the failings of others interfered with his work. It didn't take long for Rudolf to become a sensation in the Soviet Union. Everyone wanted to see this new kid dance. He just lit up a stage and had women falling in love with him and a lot of men questioning themselves, many of whom Rudolf would then go and help. Now, this is where it gets interesting. The company goes to tour around Western Europe, but a certain someone's non-conformist nature and rebellious attitude had the Russian government concerned. The French tour organizers had to beg them to let him out of the country. They did, But the KGB kept a very close eye on Rudolf while he socialised with the French dancers in Paris. They were nervous that he wanted to defect. They were right. So, Paris Airport, 1960. The morning that the company are supposed to fly to London to continue the tour. A KGB agent stops Rudolf and says that he should really come home because another ballet company want to work with him. Rudolf refuses and says he has to go to London. Then another KGB agent stops him and says that he has to come home because his mother is sick. Now Rudolf is really suspicious. He knows that if he goes home now, he'll probably never be allowed to leave the country again. A fabulous Parisian socialite named Clara was at the airport that morning. She and Rudy had become really close during his time in Paris. And Clara happened to be engaged to the son of the French Minister for Culture. So it didn't take long for there to be two undercover French policemen hovering around Rudolf at the airport. When two more KGB agents stopped him, Rudolf took six steps away from the KGB agents and towards the French policemen. When the agents ran for him, the French policemen grabbed him and, in an amazing display of French diplomacy, shouted, "Do not touch him, we are in France!" And it was done. Rudolf got on the plane to London and never went home again. The Soviet government got his mother and father and dance teachers to all write letters urging him to come home. But it never worked. It was the first defection of a Soviet artist during the Cold War. And it caused an international sensation. Now, wherever Rudy went, he was the hottest ticket in town. He was always on tour, massive star, always travelling, wherever there was an audience to perform for and hot boys to hook up with. You know, apparently, after some performances, Rudolf would be out of his costume and on the street looking for the nearest bathhouse just minutes after the curtain call ended. Oh, he would have loved Grindr. Rudolf Nureyev was, above all, a stickler for the classical technique, and his mastery of it made him a role model for an entire generation of dancers. He became the artistic director of the Paris Opera Ballet in 1983, and choreographed many beautiful ballets before he died of AIDS in 1993. But, like I said, he's most famous for those moments when he stepped out on stage. Mum says I have to keep my fluids up when I'm dancing. I really love my mum. She's the best. She's my best friend. She's not even that much older than me. She was 16 when she had me. It makes me realise how incredible Alvin Ailey was. He had a teenage mother as well, and no father figure in his life. And he went on to form the defining African-American dance company of our time. And he had a rough childhood. And I don't mean that lightly. Like, I say that I had a rough childhood, but I'm a little white boy from Australia. Our roots was really rough. 1930s, 40s America. A black man in a white man's world. And even with all of that, he still had this intense black pride that you can see in all of his work. His most famous piece is a solo for a female dancer titled Cry, which he dedicated to black women everywhere, especially our mothers. When he died of AIDS in 1989, to protect his mother, he asked the doctor to publicly announce that he died of a different disease. The connection between mother and son. There's nothing stronger. Well, we better get going if we are gonna get through a full 100 years here. So let's go to Germany. To a sleepy little German village called Wuppertal. Unabashed. Her dancers are incredibly beautiful, even the men. An eclectic, multicultural collection of individual dancers. It's like watching humanity on stage. Pina Bausch had a whole new process for creating dance. She would speak to her dancers about their experiences. She'd collaborate with them to create a whole new style. Tanztheater was born. And I don't really know how to demonstrate Pina Bausch's signature style to you. I mean, you know, inevitably when people ask to describe Pina, then they just say, it's Pina. You know, it's just Pina. Her audiences loved her. Her dancers loved her. They would tour the world to great critical acclaim and then hide away again in a little German village and create the next show. Pina Bausch was always surrounded by a haze of smoke. She always had a cigarette in her hand. You know, apparently, when the company were going to tour to Australia, Pina couldn't handle the 20-hour non-stop, non-smoking flight, so she requested that the trip be split into several legs, just a couple of hours each, so that she could get off the plane and have a ciggy. She was diagnosed with lung cancer in 2009 and died 5 days later. I'm not interested in how people move. I'm interested in what makes them move. Pina Bausch, 1940 to 2009. I miss her. I never met her, but I miss her. If I could tell you what it meant, there would be no point in me dancing it. Isadora Duncan, 1877 to 1927. Well, thanks, Isadora, but dance doesn't always have to be so abstract. Sometimes, dance can be incredibly clear. What's worse than being talked about? Not being talked about. Gay sex orgy on TV was the headline. Everyone in England was talking about it. The TV station was flooded with complaints. Politicians argued about it in Parliament. Deviate was in the spotlight. Although not intentionally. Deviate physical theatre was anything but mainstream. In fact, the whole point was to go against the grain. Performer Nigel Charnock and choreographer Lloyd Newsom founded the company. And Lloyd Newsom is a very private man. He doesn't like having his picture taken, and in interviews he wears sunglasses and hats. He started choreographing because he was frustrated. This Australian-born psychology student wanted to challenge the way that we looked at dance. What exactly does an arabesque say about love? How does rolling on the floor protest cloning? Why does a princess ballerina do 32 fouettes at her wedding? He was infuriated with dance. He was bored. In fact, he called dance the Prozac of the art forms. Roy Newsom's dance film, Dead Dreams for Monochrome Men, is loosely based on the true story of serial killer Dennis Nielsen, a lonely gay man who would lure victims back to his apartment, kill them, bathe them, clothe them, and then keep them for company. So when that aired on national TV in 1988, that caused a lot of controversy, but it was a chance for Lloyd to show us what he meant by dance that means something. Lloyd Newsom's works have discussed forced marriages, freedom of speech, the battle between religion and sexuality, tolerance and intolerance in multiculturalism, social class, and gender norms. Just light entertainment, really. DVA physical theatre may have been formed to reject the mainstream, but since then, Lloyd Newsom has been called a theatrical genius, a man who reinvents the rules, bravely confrontational. Lloyd Newsom himself has said, "I only create when I have something to say."
Brave enough to keep
dance like a rich man. I wanted to dance in a pair of jeans. I wanted to dance like a man in the streets. Once said that the two hardest things she ever had to do in life were childbirth and making Singing in the Rain. Sid Charisse once said, my husband always knew which dancer I was working with. If it was Fred, I didn't have a scratch. And if I was black and blue, it was Jean. Who am I? I am the son of a factory worker and a secretary. I dropped out of high school to play Baby John in Jerome Robbins' West Side Story. I dated a man, Larry Fuller, also a choreographer. But I married a woman, Donna McKechnie, but only for a few months. I had an affair with a married woman who actually left her husband and children to be with me. But it didn't work out. By the time I died of AIDS-related lymphoma in July of 1989, I was a drug and alcohol-addicted bisexual who had become paranoid in my later life and convinced the Italian mafia were out to get me. Michael Bennett. He was fabulous. He choreographed and directed Dreamgirls, Follies, Seesaw, Company, and of course, a chorus line. 5, 6, 7, 8. A chorus line was Michael Bennett's big project. He co-choreographed it with Bob Avian, and he directed it himself. What he did was he got all of his dancer friends in one room and then recorded them talking about how they became dancers, their family, their childhood, and why they do what they do. And those recordings became the first ever verbatim text musical.
I mean, this is terrific. Here I am, a gypsy from Santa Monica, presenting the award to, wait a minute, maybe I better explain to the audience at home that the term gypsy lovingly applies to all dancers in the Broadway theater. And all dancers need a choreographer. Desperately. The nominees for best choreographer of a Broadway play are Michael Bennett and Bob Avian, A Chorus Line, Patricia Birch, Pacific Overtures, Bob Fosse, Chicago, and Billy Wilson for Bubbling Brown Sugar. And the winner is, okay, Michael Bennett and Bob Avian.
So many people did so much to help me get this. And not only Joe Papp and Marvin and Ed and Nick and Jimmy and Bobby and the nine orchestrators and Bobby Thomas and the cast and my darling Donna McKechnie, but everybody that I've had the opportunity to work with in theater. They've all taught me things, and I only wanted one thing, to be a Broadway director. And I am, and I want it one moment, and I have it. My thank you.
A Chorus Line broke the record for the longest running Broadway show, 6,137 performances. But in 1999, it was surpassed by Cats. And in 2011, that record was broken by Chicago. Originally by Bob Fosse, who lost the Tony Award that night to Michael Bennett. Awards, they don't mean anything. But they don't hurt. Ready? Okay, tell the papers, tell the magazines, call the newsreader. There's a new kid in town, and she's a cheerleader. The year is 1980, so tell the whole world there's a brand new member of the Lego Girl. Give me an A, a B, a D, U, L. Cause Paul Abdul is gonna give you hell. And she did. Only 1 year after Paula Abdul joined the Lego Girl squad, she was their head choreographer. And when the Jackson family, yep, the Jackson family, went to a Lakers game, Paula caught their eye. They invited her to choreograph a new thing, a music video for their new single.
Paula quickly became one of the most sought-after choreographers at the height of the music video era, and then became a pop star in her own right. She disappeared from the public eye for a while. But she later explained that she had been in a car crash and a plane crash and had 15 surgeries on her spine. She came back into our lives with reality TV when everyone remembered what an incredible dancer she was. And yes, I'm lip syncing. You see what she did? What, you think she could have danced like that if she was actually singing?
Right, I've got so much more that I wanted to tell you, because because I'm running out of time, and I just, you know how, like, on RuPaul's Drag Race, when, like, Queen gets eliminated in, like, the first or second episode, and she's like, oh, I'm just really disappointed that I had to go so early because I have so much more that I wanted to show. But, you know, they actually mean that as well, because the producers for that show, they tell the queens what looks to prepare, like, for every episode, just in case they get all the way through to the finale. They have to have a look prepared. So, you know, an outfit that represents your city, or a black and white look, or a Madonna kimono. And so, when the queen says, there's just so much more that I wanted to show, they don't just mean, like, bits of their personality that they didn't get to show on national television. They mean there's, like, stuff actually in their suitcase that they didn't get to pull out. I feel a bit like that because I haven't told you anything about Busby Berkeley or Paul Lightfoot and Solion. I haven't even mentioned Siraj Khan or Graham Murphy or Gary Stewart. Okay. I've got it. You want it. And I'm going to give it to you. Janet Jackson, 1966 present. The starter of the neoclassical movement and founder of the New York City Ballet. He married four ballerinas and divorced four ballerinas. Lucy Kieran, William and Joe Frester, Bert Toll, the Electric Boogaloo, Vaslav Nijinsky, amazing ballet dancer and choreographer of Afternoon of the Fawn, which in 1912 caused a whole lot of controversy because it included a mimed masturbation scene at the end. When he was at the Ballet Russes, Vaslav Nijinsky choreographed a trio for three men, but the artistic director of Ballet Russes, Sergei Diaghilev, suggested that he change one of those roles to a woman because it was all getting a bit homoerotic, even though Diaghilev was sleeping with Nijinsky at the time. Also, he was a schizophrenic. Susan Stroman, Moshe Savard, Rudy Harris, Jamie King, Agnes DeMille, responsible for shows like Carousel, Oklahoma, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. She died of a stroke at age 88, and she was a collector of fine china and an expert on the history of clothes. Shane Sparks, Bilty Jones, Natalie Duarte, Paul Taylor, Jerome Robbins, choreographer, director, producer of the Hollywood, Ballet, Broadway, Jewish, responsible for shows like Fiddler on the Roof, West Side Story, and The Thing and I. Raphael Bonachal, Akram Khan, known for his London-based dance company, which blends contemporary dance with traditional Indian Kathak dance. Hoffa Shetto, Yuri Killian, Stephen Page, Twyla Tharp, yes, known for her signature wit. She choreographed 129 dances, 12 television specials, 6 Hollywood movies, 4 full-length ballets, 4 Broadway shows, and 2 figure skating routines. Debbie Allen, Tony Basil, Kenneth McMillan, Trisha Brown, Wayne McGregor, Tommy Chun, Javon Davies, Christopher Wheeldon, Crystal Pite, Ohad Marin, Matthew Bourne and Azur Barton, and I'm just so glad they all exist. I love them all, and I wrote this list to celebrate the last 100 years of exceptional movement pioneers. And the reason I love them, the good and the bad, is how inventive they were with what they had. Because every choreographer in history worked with the same anatomy. You've got abduction, adduction, contraction, and extension. Don't forget rotation, dorsiflexion, plantar flexion, circumduction, pronation, protraction, then there's inversion, supination, and retraction. There are hinge joints, pivot joints, ball and socket joints. There are points of perfect balance and several counterpoints. Flex foot, pointed foot, bent or straight knee, you can move it all together or sequentially. A jump must land and a twist affects all the other body parts because it all connects from your weight-bearing feet to your fingertips. The spine connects the head to the hips, and a dancer's body can do many things now, but only what the laws of physics allow. So you test and experiment and try to create with a constant pressure to innovate. There's only so many moves that a body can do, and you think of one, but they've done that too. Let me tell you, there is nothing new under the sun, and you just have to start to get the job done. These guys have done it. They've made the grade. They're household names because of what they've made, but for the rest of us who want to make dance, we're not blessed with that same circumstance. It's a hard act to follow. Is there room for me? Because I want to find my place on the family tree. Free to be on the list, to be part of the team, to be just like the people who have already been, to be making art, creating dance, finding a voice. voice and then given a chance, I know I can do it. I'm sure I can, to be something more special than from where I began. Because in my head, I've got a little bitty tendency to have my own technique and build a legacy. In my head, I'm a legend. In my head, I'm a gem. My name's on the list. I'm one of them. One day, a student will be studying me. Here's a little glimpse to my fantasy. I'm going to be famous and I'm going to be proud when I leave the stage door to a screaming crowd. A wall of cheers like a ton of bricks. Smile for the selfie, wave for the pics, jump in fan to fan like a kangaroo. And thank you so much. That's so nice of you. So many of them, I can't tell them apart. They all love my ideas. They all love my art. They're all pushing and shoving and trying to get through. You want a piece of me? Let me tell you what to do. Hold up your phones. I'll pose and pow for you. Hit you with my autograph. Let me spell it out for you. J to the A to the C to the O to the B. Kids got nothing on me. I hope you're all enjoying the meet and greet, but get back, boys. Can't compete with the elite. The critics squeal when I move my feet, and I won't stop even when the beat's complete. Because I'm making moves like you've never seen in my linear dreams, if you know what I mean. The hits keep coming like they never end, and I know you want to be my friend. So if you want to know where it's at, don't look at me. I can't tell you that. This part is exclusive. My circle is actually no. Sorry, that's not what I want. I don't want to be famous. That's not the point. That's not what these guys did. They just started. If you want to be a choreographer, you have to make dances. Mark Morris, 1956 to present. Dance is for everyone. Dance is for celebrating. It's for grieving. It's for making rain. It's primal and natural. It's about music and connection and moving your body. You know what? We're going to learn a dance. Everybody stand up. Everybody stand up. I know, I hate audience participation as well. Can we get the help on that, please? I'm going to teach you all a dance. Okay, it's not amazing, but it's mine. So what we're going to do is we're going to imagine that we've gone shopping, we've got a really nice pair of pants. A really nice pair of pants. So we're in the fitting room, we're going to come out of the fitting room and go, yes, these are the pants, Lord. Right, right. Imagine just more careful than people are. Alright, so get into your fitting room, here we go, ready, coming out and go! Yes! Fantastic. You don't have to say anything. Look at the pants from all the different angles. Yes, these pants are going to work for me. And then we've decided that these pants are so good that we don't want to wear anything else. So we're just going to take off the sweater. So we're going to cross it out. And I'm like, yep, try it, you've got to try it. It's rehearsal. Like a pants. And then we're going to take these pants out into the street. And everyone is going to see these magnificent pants. Everyone. Both hands. Wonderful, and then we're going to take those pants down to the river, and we're going to get into a rowboat, which is going to be two rows on this and two rows on this side. Amazing! So we're not really scared of those crocodiles. Punch them out! Alright, so we're gonna do four punches in front of you. We're gonna do one, two, three, four. Alright, awesome. Quick rows. So crocodile on this side, crocodile on this side, four punches. One, two, three, four.
Oh, I think that.
educational and amazing.
Fantastic. Brilliant.
There wasn't a minute when I wasn't entertained.
Best history lesson I've been to in a long time.
That's fantastic.
Impressed. Amazing.
So energetic and just completely entertaining. I just laughed my ass off.
You could just feel a passion radiating off him. It was amazing.
My jaw, I'm literally massaging it because it was hilarious.
Jaw drop.
He was phenomenal.
Absolutely amazing.
Everyone should see.
Energetic, exceptional, and exhilarating.
I like the finale bit where he just went non-stop. Yeah. And his Nureyev. Oh, gorgeous.
The fussy moment though.
Oh!
It's really inspiring.
It manages to encapsulate all the joy and celebration and imagination and creativity of all the people that we aspire to be like.
One word?
Phenomenal.